To begin this interview, we would like to know, where did you attend for high school?
Oh, I went to Hart High School here in Yonkers. My parents, I'm one of 16 children, were very much wanted us to have faith-based education, so all of us went to Catholic High School right here in our city.
And so my question is, were you like a good student in school? Did you get like the good grade?
No, I really wasn't a great student, and that's really unfortunate. I think I actually struggled as a student. I also had a speech impediment, and I was where I would go 2 or 3 times a week to a speech therapist to deal with that too. So, we all have challenges, and some people are smarter than others, right? But I think that, you meet those challenges and you move on. So,
what college did you go to, and how was it?
Okay, I went to Manhattan College. I did not finish college because I felt that I could go out and go to work, and I did. I actually worked in the private sector, and I worked for an oil company. Did very, very well at a very young age, and always said I would go back and finish at night. Never did. I had about 2.5 years of college. I should have went back and finished. So if I, and that's why I said I wasn't a great student, and that was always something that I look at and go, oh, I'll go back to school. It's okay. And go back there doing the homework and doing all that, because I love being free. I love doing, especially if I was, working in the business sector and working for an oil, we did oil sales and heating contracts. It was what I loved doing. I loved dealing with people. So I got to jump right into that early. But that's not a suggested path for those of you who might want to be mayor or president, but it was my path, and I think, like you said, the path I chose, I think, best prepared me, but just in a different way.
Thank you. I know you mentioned it earlier, but are there any other challenges you had to overcome to get to where you are today?
Everyone has their issues. Overall, my life has been very good life. I'm one of 16 children. I have tremendous love in my family, a lot of support. I have, married to a very wonderful person with 3 children, and our children, all have do pretty well at school because we're on them. We make sure of that. I had, when I was 13 years old, I'd been a victim of sexual assault, and I never really talked about it until I ran for the assembly. And I ran for the assembly. You guys know about Megan's Law? You guys know about Megan's Law? Okay. Oh, that's interesting. I guess the time goes by, I don't realize all this. But one of the things that when I was the youngest member of the New York City Legislature at the time, I was 27 years old, got elected to the New York City Legislature, and we were having discussions about sexual assault, and I led a legislative task force on sexual assault. And one of the things that we recommended, we didn't come out with this, was a law called Megan's Law that was named after a young girl who was raped and then died of her injuries. And this person who did this crime, did the crime over and over and over again. And as it turned out, those people who commit sexual crimes of sexual nature, right, are 7 times greater chance of what they call recidivism rate, 7 times greater, right? So really what it means is that, without getting too deep into all this stuff, but it means that if you're somebody who would commit that type of crime, you will, if you get away with it, do it over and over and over and over again. And so our best defense against somebody who's committed that type of crime is to know who that person is. So Megan's Law is where you take people who are sexual predators, you put their faces online, right? They end up on the internet. So you know if that person lives next to your house, they'll say that person's a level one, a level two, a level three sex offender. You know that that person lives there. And that's not to so that people would hurt that person. We certainly don't want that. What we want is to be able to best safeguard our families against someone like that. So you know, tell your child, that house, you don't go near that house, you stay away from that house. And that was a very important law that we got passed. I was very, very young, and I used my experience that I had when I was 13 years old to stand up in front of the assembly and talk about that. And I spoke in very much in detail about what happened to me and why we needed to pass a law that would keep people who do these types of crimes either in jail longer, or if they're in their community, we ought to know who they are and where they are, because that's our best defense against another victim happening again. So I guess you could say that, again, that shapes you, you know, that part of your life shapes who you are. And so we all have our experiences, we all have the things that you all will go through in your life. You'll say, geez, you know what, that's wrong, I like to fix that. Or that annoys me, I like to change that, right? Well, it's essentially what drove me into politics. There are things that I wanted to change and things that I wanted to do as a state legislator and as a mayor, and I'm given the opportunity to do them now.
And before, you mentioned that you were married. You know, you're married to the TV journalist, Mary Calvi. Mm-hmm. How did you two meet?
It's so funny. I was part of this committee called the Columbus Day Committee, right? Yonkers has it. It's 80-something years old. And, sorry. So I'm part of this committee, and they always do, and it's basically a celebration of Italian heritage, right? They do in October every year. So it's, you know, the Columbus Day Parade, the dinner, the breakfast, the night at the races. It's a whole series of events, you know, that, and they also had a Miss Columbus. And Mary was a senior in high school. She wanted to go to Syracuse University. And she came in to that committee, and I was on that committee. So that's when I met her. That's when we got to talk a lot. We spent a lot of time together, but then she went off to Syracuse and spent 4 years there, and I went off to what I was doing. And we really didn't get back together again until she came back, and she graduated, and she came back. We got married, we had our first child. Then she got an agent, and she went as a reporter. CBS, and then that, of course, led to becoming an anchor. And so she's been, you know, now in this business for 22 years and has been the anchor for about 8 years now. So, but she, you know, she's very talented, very, very smart. Wondering why she's with me, right? Yes.
Do you and Mrs. Spano have any pets?
Yes, we have Lola. Lola's a little Cocker Spaniel. What's the other? Hardest Cocker Spaniel Labrador mixture.
Okay.
And so she's very cute. I should have pictures.
So I'm pretty sure you consider Lola like another child.
Oh yeah, well Lola's been with us now for about a year and a half. And she's very much a part of the family. So she's I really didn't want a dog because I don't want to have to walk her. Daughter kicks in, and she walks the first thing in the morning, so that helps out a lot.
And for your three children, what schools do they go to?
Okay, I have three. One is a freshman, one is a junior in high school, so freshman in high school, junior high school, and a freshman in college. My son Christopher goes to Stepanak, mm-hmm. right? So my daughter goes to Maria Regina. Again, Mary and I, both of us all went through Catholic school. Mary went to St. Anne's and to Maria Regina, and I went to St. Bart and the Lady Mount Carmel. So our children are continue that tradition. And Michael is at the University of Maryland, Baltimore County. So
you've already mentioned why you wanted to go into politics, but what were some of the things that you wanted to change when you first ran for mayor of Yonkers, and what were some of the deciding factors that made you run for said position?
One of the things I wanted to change when I became mayor was to change the image of the city, because the image was such that it was always fighting, it was always, there were always issues, corruption, some other issues like that. There was, you know, there was always a lot of talk, a lot of crime, there was a lot of talk of a lot of dysfunctionality, especially in our schools. And you know, and when you really looked at the and like what the truth was, Yonkers is a very different city than what people have said. Now listen, it doesn't mean we don't have our problems. I mean, we do, every city does. Every city has got, cities were built on manufacturing bases, and those, right? And those manufacturers used to pay a lot in taxes. And then you had like a strong middle class. And then you of course had a struggling population, especially the immigrant population that would come in. You know, Yonkers is an immigrant city. Back to our history, you know, it was the, you know, the Germans, there was the Irish, and there was the Italians, and you know, and of course, you know, then you can mix in, you know, the Jordanians and that group, and of course, you know, the newest immigrants and the Latinos. But it's always been a very good experience. What we're seeing now in our cities, though, is that the manufacturing bases have kind of dried up, so you don't have that base anymore. You have a middle class that struggles, but when you raise taxes on the middle class, it has a problem. It has a real impact. And our struggling populations are becoming more expensive, far more expensive than what our tax payers keep up with. So that's our challenge. We're seeing a renaissance in our cities. It's a good renaissance. Things are starting to turn around, but it's a very fragile. And so that's why, if you hear me, I will always try to speak in very positive tones about the city, especially if you feel like my state of city addresses. I'm telling the positive story all the time. Doesn't mean I'm ignoring the negative stuff. I deal with the negative stuff. I deal with that every day. But I got to tell the positive story, because the people that live in our community need to believe in where they live. They need to believe that there's a future here for them and for their children and for their grandchildren. So. And there is. And there is no perfect community in this world. There just isn't. Nova Scarsdale, trust me, is six times greater salary than we do, and I will bet you that they have just as many issues as we do, per person. So I don't know if I answered your question. I might have went around in circles, but you know, it's
like, did.
Okay.
Thank you.
So being mayor of this city, you're entitled to a number of responsibilities within the city. Any issues that occur, you're held accountable for them. So what is your typical day like in office?
Oh, wow. I don't know. Then what's our typical day?
Lots.
I always say 10 crises a day.
Your morning meeting.
Yeah. I mean, for the most part, right. I mean, I drop off my son to school. I'm in work, 8:30 every morning. I go home whenever. That whenever could be 10, 11 at night. It could be 5. It could be 5. I can run home, have dinner with my wife and kids for a little bit, and then go back out and do. Because the responsibility of mayor isn't just being here and dealing with the day-to-day operations of the city, but it's also being out and being in the community and communicating with the community, you know, what's happening in the city. And so that requires me to be out of line. But when you're here, remember, because it's a strong mayor, so I don't know if you guys know anything about that, but there are some local governments that are built like this, where the council and the mayor are part of one legislative body, right? And then there are other forms of government, like Yonkers, where the mayor is separate from the council. It's a strong mayor, who means I run the day-to-day operations of the city. People like me run the city, so I pick the police commissioner, fire commissioner, I pick, you know, the parks commissioner, public works commissioner, and then I pick the trustees to the Board of Education. So there's a lot of responsibility surrounding the ruling person. And so that means you're held accountable. You're held accountable for what everyone does in this town or what they don't do. This job, if you want to be in a position to affect real change in a community that you were born and raised in and that you love, there's no better job. You know, I say I want a green car, trust me, there's a green car out there tomorrow, right? But with putting all that fun stuff aside, there are times that it's very, very difficult. There are times if people do some things that, you know, there's 8,000 people that work for Yonkers in terms of the Board of Education and the city side. If somebody does something and it brings a shadow on the city, you know, I have to deal with that person. And sometimes when you deal with the person, sometimes, you know, I have to, let's say, fire a firefighter because of something they did outside their job, or something that brought discredit to them as a firefighter that was illegal. That's a really hard decision to make, because not only am I firing you, but you probably have a wife and kids. Now I'm taking your ability to earn away from you. It's a really hard thing to do. So the fun parts of the job are there, and that's good, but there are parts of the job that are very difficult. Some of it, like you said, is disciplining, firing, all that stuff falls back on the mayor. The decisions will eventually be the mayor's decision. And dealing with budgets, and you know, we're gonna be dealing with a very difficult budget that I'm gonna propose tomorrow. You know, we're going to, you know, maybe we're going to lay off 150 people. Now, out of that many people, you probably say, well, that's not such a big deal. But you know what? It is a big deal if you're one of those people, because they have families. We don't want to do that, obviously. And so we have a lot of work to do. But there, I'll need the help of, you know, of the council and the unions to try and bring it all together. But that's my job as mayor. My job is to figure it out, put it together, because all the people want to know is that I'm keeping the city moving, keeping it calm, holding people accountable, and keeping taxes as low as possible. That's what people want to know. And if I'm doing that, I'm okay. So.
If you could go back in time and change something you've done in your life, would you, and what would it be?
You know, it's funny you say that, because I think if I went back in my life, I could do anything differently. I would have focused much more on school, because I really think that there was, you know, I really had, you know, I felt that there are other things I could have done in my life in addition to, you know, to fulfilling my dream to be mayor. There were other things I could have done in my life that I didn't do or couldn't do because I didn't finish school the way I would have liked to.
Could you name one triumph in your career?
What's that?
Could you name one triumph in your career?
A challenge?
A triumph.
A triumph?
Yeah.
That was my biggest triumph, was win, because a lot of people would have never run again after they lost. And I was going to let that be my legacy. My legacy was I was going to be mayor, and I was going to figure out how to do it. And so, put my efforts into making it happen.
Thank you.
All right, so a few years back, you originally affiliated with the Republican Party, and now you have identified yourself with the Democratic Party. What were some of the driving factors that motivated you to change political affiliations?
That's a very good question. By the way, it was 12 years ago that I had switched. I was a Republican my whole life. My father was a Republican. My father was in public office. My brother was in public office. And, you know, I was a Republican, but I ran in the then 87th Assembly District. Now, that district that I ran in and I won at 27 years old was a 3-1 Democratic by enrollment. 3-1 Democratic district held previously by a Democrat, and it was said that a Republican couldn't win that district, and I ran. But why? How did I win? I guess that's the question, right? Because how do you run in a democratic area and win? Clearly, you must be a little more democratic-minded. And so while I was born a Republican, I kind of, in my opinion, evolved to be a Democrat, because I was always for, I was one of the first Republicans to support the gay marriage. Matter of fact, I was probably one of the first legislators, even because neither side, that when I supported, ever wanted to support gay marriage. Nobody wanted to support it. That was something that everyone seemed to be against, and then once it passed, all of a sudden everybody was for it. But nobody was for it for the longest time. I was always for women's reproductive freedom. So I was always, and these were things that were not traditionally Republican issues. And, there were Republicans used to say, why are you Republican? But I was conservative on other issues. I was for Megan's Law, which was more of a conservative-minded issue. And that's something that the Democrats did not want to do. They didn't want to do that bill. So on criminal matters, I was probably a little more conservative. I'm probably more middle of the road in taxes, and socially I'm very progressive, right? So it's a nice way of saying liberal. So that's kind of how I evolved to where I am today. But I was born a Republican, loved my father to death, and love him. He's 88 years old, and he's just a really, really smart man. And except he supported candidate for president, but I won't get into that. So,
thank you. But
he's hard for Republicans, so he could probably figure out his support.
Okay, so we noticed that after Parkland, more and more students in our school were very aware of problems that would have been an issue, God forbid, that was our school. So our question to you is, what are your plans moving forward to make school safe?
Absolutely. We are in the process of training our teachers, all of our teachers, on active shooting. We are training our administrators on active shooting. So we have a police department, our special investigations unit, this is what they do. They have trained all of our safety officers on active shooters. They've changed the protocols. So if there is an active shooter in the school, our police officers are trained to immediately go in and engage. It used to be that they would go, if there was an active shooter in the school, they would go to the school, they would wait outside for reinforcements to come, they would pick their train, wherever it is, and they would go in. That's no longer the case. When a police officer shows up on the scene, they have a police officer, which is unfortunate that they're putting their lives in danger, but they are going in and engage. Your safety officers that are in the schools, new radios. The radios are going to include the police frequency as part of their radios. So they will now not only just communicate with the principal, but they will communicate with law enforcement, because they're in the school and they know the school and they know what's going on. We have just started to change security platforms of our schools. It's expensive though, and so it's $300,000 a school to do the complete security platform. But every school, every grammar school has a lock buzzer with a camera. We know that. But we're looking to do is put cameras at a vantage point, and also be able to lock schools down with a button, be able to turn the lights on and off with a button. It's expensive. For every school, like I said, it costs $300 to $500 million. That's a lot of money. So we're working and trying to get the money for that. But we've done a couple of schools, but we have a lot more work to do there. So this is what we've done so far. We have a lot more work to do, but I think we're probably ahead of most.
And you touched on this a little bit before, about new budget plans. But according to LOHA, they say Yonkers is $46 million in the hole. So what are three main things you consider when creating either a new budget or tax plan?
any budget are cuts, aid. We say aid, what we can get from Washington or Auburn, they've been called into pockets. Or when I say cuts, aid, or additional revenues. I say additional revenues, that means tax increases. The way our government works is we just give money to more education. And that sounds, but I mean, it's not as simple as that, but that's basically what education is run by the board trustees and the superintendent. The city gives money to board education, the state gives money to board education, and then they determine how they spend that money. So there's a shortfall. Dr. Pizarro, the trustees, probably in consultation with me, but they will make the final decisions as to, you know, what areas they will trim to balance the budget. On the city side, that's all new. So, in government, obviously, in the city council. So, I have to make a decision, you know, do we cut cops, do we cut firefighters, do we cut parks employees, do we cut, guys who pick up our trash. And those are very hard decisions to make because, you know, asking, you know, your constituents, well, would you rather cut two teachers or two cops? You know, it's like asking which one to cut. You know, you can't really ask that question. You know, that's a really tough question to ask. That's why they elect you to office. You have to make these decisions. You do the best you can. And you try to make it work. We've had deficits before. We've been able to close gaps. Imagine that to go back to the beginning of the interview. The big city. We're always going to have issues. A lot of our challenges, and people will judge us based on how we met those challenges. We meet this challenge too. Not sure how yet, but we have a lot of work to do.
Do you have any other new projects in
store for us? We have about $2 billion in private investment in the city right now. Lots of great projects. There's 4,000 units of housing being built on the Northeast Edge. There are, we have the area of Chicken House, which is right here. We have four different companies right now that are fighting for that lot. One of them wants to put it like in Italy set up and a new movie theater, like a dinner theater. Upgraded development. Yeah, it's supposed to be very cool. So that's just one of them. You know, the good thing is that there is a lot of economic development happening around the city. And that's good, because that brings in more tax revenue. But the problem that we have is our expenses are still growing at a greater rate than what we're bringing in tax revenue. So yeah, we're bringing in more revenue, a lot more. But our revenue, like our cost of our workforce and the fringe benefits, are still outpacing our ability to